My topic this evening, giving a reason for the hope that is within you. What I want to do is, what I have before me really is one lecture, but it's a long lecture. I'm going to break it into two halves. I want to do the pessimistic part first. I want to look at how and why the culture around us is changing in the way it is, and then offer some proposals as to what we should be doing in order to give a reason for the hope that is within us as the culture around transforms. I'm not familiar with Northern Irish culture, but I'm guessing in the same way as England and Scotland and the United States of America, it is probably secularizing at some pace in a way that is set not to be reversed anytime soon. So it is important to understand, if you like, the difficulties of the context in which we are in. Christians in the West have enjoyed unusual power and influence in their cultures for a long time. Part of my brief at Westminster is I teach the ancient church course, I teach the medieval church course, and I teach the Reformation church course. And it's very interesting that once you get to the 4th century in the history of the church, you really reach a point where the church has increasing power and influence within society. And that has continued by and large unchallenged until really the last 150 years. And I would say that even within the last 150 years, perhaps the last 20 years or 25 years have seen more of a decline and more of an accelerating of anti-Christian forces than perhaps in the previous 1500 years. Of course, the problem always remains the same. The problem is fallen human beings in rebellion against God. But the cultural context in which we now operate is somewhat different to that which it has been in the past. We have, as I said, a happy coincidence for many centuries between Christian ethics, if you like, and public morality. It is increasingly the case that that does not apply anymore, and it is a complete game changer for the church. So I want to start by making some general observations about the broader Western culture within which we live, and then offering five or six proposals of things that we should be engaged in doing now in order to be able to meet this challenge effectively. There is a lot of talk about cultural engagement in the church. Much of it, I think, seems to mean simply finding out what forms the culture uses and adopting and adapting them in the church. It's a Reformed Presbyterian church, thankfully, I'm sure, immune to debates about contemporary worship. But those of you familiar with churches that have gone through debates about contemporary worship, often the language of engaging the culture comes up. We have to engage the culture by changing the form of worship in one way or another. That is not the kind of cultural engagement I want to talk about tonight. Culture, I think, is not pop songs. Culture is not sports. Culture is not television. All of these things play a part in culture, but considered in themselves, they are not such. Culture, I would say, is the systems by which values are cultivated and transmitted. And from a Christian perspective, I would say culture is the system by which the truth is suppressed. First thing about the culture around us is I think that what has happened is that Christianity has been not so much disproved as been rendered implausible. Various things have taken place in the world around us that make the Christian message a very hard one for the culture to swallow. The war against history. We live in a profoundly anti-historical age. We live in an age where if you're a professional student of history, you'll often be told that history is all about power. It's not really about the past at all. We construct historical stories in order to exert past in the power over the present. On the other side of the coin, there's tremendous ignorance of history among people today. I was in class last week and I made a reference to say I'm a big fan of Western movies, I made a reference to John Wayne's film The Searchers, and nobody in class had seen it. And I suspect that probably 80% of the students there had not heard of John Wayne either. Relatively trivial point, but people don't think about the past. Even Christians don't think about the past today. And that's a major challenge for Christianity on two fronts. First of all, Christianity's significance lies in its claim that God has acted in history, and that its particular historical claims, its particular historical story, if you like, has universal significance. And secondly, the second problem, of course, is the church has a history which has not always been a very admirable or fine one, and makes it easy for people to take pot shots at the church. In the American context, it is very difficult to sell Presbyterianism to African Americans, for example, because of the strong connection between Presbyterianism and slavery in history. Perhaps if I can throw a compliment the Reformed Presbyterian direction, the Reformed Presbyterian Church in North America was the one Presbyterian church that was abolitionist and stood against slavery. But the general point is, our history is portrayed as oppressive. And that is a problem in making our message plausible today. Secondly, there is the dominance of scientific ways of thinking. Scientific ways of thinking claim to offer exhaustive accounts of reality. It is, of course, a sleight of hand. If you listen to Richard Dawkins, it's amazing how much the language of morality creeps into what he has to say. That Christianity is immoral. One is left wondering what the basis for saying that anything is immoral, if ultimately we live within a universe that can be exhaustively explained in scientific and naturalist terms. So it's a sleight of hand, but it still exerts huge power within our culture. Consumerism also is a great problem. Consumerism offers fulfillment here and now via material means. As well as teaching at Westminster, I pastor a small congregation in the OPC in a nearby town. One of the challenges I've thrown out to the congregation over the months is, what are the most dangerous things you watch on television? The answers usually come back, well, sex and violence. To which my response would be, no, those are actually some of the less dangerous things you might come across, because they're relatively easy to spot. You're watching a violent program, you see it's violent, you can switch it off. Watching a program with a sex scene, you can switch it off. The most dangerous things you see on television, of course, are things you don't even notice. What are the things you don't even notice? The commercials, the adverts, constantly preaching a gospel to people watching the television that if you buy this thing or possess this service, your life will be more fulfilled than it has been. The consumerist paradigm is dangerous precisely because we don't even notice how pervasive it is in the culture around us. Another thing dangerous about the current culture, and this is becoming increasingly obvious, and that is the repudiation of any notion of human nature. Partly, I think it connects to consumerism. What does consumerism do? It tells you, you can be anything you want to be by using your money, by using your purchasing power to reinvent yourself. In more sinister and obvious forms, I think we see it in the debates about gender and sexuality. I was very struck last week. A couple, I can't remember which state they're in the United States, are suing the local church, the local school authority for not allowing their 5-year-old transgender child to use the girls' bathroom. And it struck me as interesting that here you have the absolute plasticity, the absolute negotiability of human nature. It isn't even as if a 5-year-old is really old enough to make any kind of responsible decision that way. But the idea is that one can be whatever one wants to be. That nature imposes no restrictions on us. But also add the war against age and maturity. Our wider culture prioritizes youth, I think, by and large, for economic reasons. It's an easy sell, isn't it? Buy this and you'll look younger. Not quite sure that, you know, buy this and you'll look older is necessarily going to win you many fans. I made the terrible error recently, coming back from a trip. I always try to buy my wife a present, and I was duty free in the airport I was in was so tiny that all I could do was grab a couple of cosmetics off the shelf, pay for them, and then stick them in my bag. And when I got home and gave them to her, they were anti-aging cream and anti-wrinkle cream. And let's just put it this way. I'll make sure I get her a much nicer present from Heathrow when I'm travelling back on Monday. But youth culture, youth is prioritised by the world around us in strange ways. It's interesting, isn't it, how pop stars are often asked for their opinion on really rather complicated political and social issues. Have you ever wondered why that's the case? I think it probably reflects a society where somehow we come to think as children as being more innocent and as therefore having a wiser access to the world. Whereas by and large, in almost any other field one could think of, age and experience would be considered important for being properly qualified to comment, but not on the great philosophical issues that face our culture today. And that, of course, is a direct hit against the church. If the church emphasizes human nature as non-negotiable, and that makes it difficult in the current culture, I think the church, because it's the church, has to privilege age. It's one of the striking things, I think, about Paul's list of qualifications for eldership, that it's to be somebody of good reputation. Well, you don't gain a good reputation overnight. You gain a good reputation by being somebody of standing within the church community or within the wider community. But that's a problem for the plausibility of the church today. The rise of mysticism and pragmatism, the spiritualities of self-help and personal realization. You find these on those dreadful chat shows that play interminably on the television. The constant references to spirituality. You find it in the resurgence of interest in things like the lost gospels. If you look at these lost gospels, if you look at the material that people like Bart Ehrman are writing about, by and large they are mystical and inward looking in terms of where they are attempting to find meaning. And there's the chaos of information, the internet, 24-hour news cycles, the cacophonous nature of modern media. I was having breakfast with a young man just 10 days ago, and he said to me, he said, one of my problems is I don't know who to listen to anymore. He said, I get the TV, I've got the internet, I've got my pastor, I've got the elders. I just don't know who to listen to and where authority lies anymore. Makes it very problematic for a religion that is inextricably tied to an institution, the church, to make itself plausible in modern society. And then finally, the last sort of thing to note, the prevalence and power of stories. A lot is made about this today, that we've moved into an age where people think in terms of stories. I actually think people have always thought in terms of stories. The Bible is full of stories. The Odyssey and the Iliad are great stories. The Greek myths, the Norse sagas, these are great stories. People have always thought in terms of stories. I do think the issue is being intensified with current media, television, internet and video. Television, the stories that are seen on television, I think have become the primary means of moral and ethical formation in our society. I want to talk in a little bit more detail about this, but first of all I want to throw out a definition of worldliness. If I were to ask you to define worldliness, what would you might come up with? Well, it's greed, or it's sexual indulgence, or it's materialism, or something like this. I want to give a more general definition of worldliness and then apply it to the power of things like movies and television. I'd say worldliness is anything which makes sin seem normal and attractive, and godliness seem weird and ugly. Think of that. Worldliness is anything which makes sin seem normal and attractive, and godliness seem weird and ugly. Take, for example, probably the single greatest moral issue, social, cultural issue of our day, the shift on attitudes towards homosexuality. I don't think the arguments on homosexuality has been lost. I don't think there has ever been an argument. What has happened is the culture has been transformed by the power of stories. I was very struck at my own. I have two boys, 19 and 17, and it has been very interesting to me to watch them grow up and wrestle with some of the great ethical challenges that they've been faced with at school, and now the oldest ones at university. And it really brought home to me how the world has changed in the last 30 years. I went to a state grammar school in England. It was an all-boys school, as already been mentioned. We were a rugby-playing school. Very sorry, by the way, to see the passing of the era of O'Gara. I thought he was a truly great rugby player. Somewhat indisciplined at points, but a great, great rugby player. It was an easy sell to people of my generation to oppose homosexuality. To put it in the bluntest and sort of crudest terms, I guess we grew up in a homophobic culture that just happened in some practical ways to coincide with the teaching of the Bible. The whole cultural gravitational pull, if you like, predisposed one to accept biblical teaching. I use the word homophobic advisedly there because I don't think that the anti-homosexual bias of the school I was at was a godly thing. I think it was generated by prejudice. But it created a culture in which was very easy to hold to the biblical position on homosexuality. That has fundamentally changed. And it's changed very, very fast. I don't know how closely you follow American politics, but 4 years ago, Rick Warren, Rick Warren is certainly not a hard-line reformed church leader in the United States. He would hardly have been invited to say the prayer at President Obama's first inaugural if he was. Rick Warren was invited to say this prayer, and it emerged that despite all of the great work that he'd done, of which the American left would approve, he'd provide a lot of money for clean water in Africa, for famine relief, things like that, it emerged that he held the biblical position on homosexuality. And there was a storm of protest, but he was still allowed to say the prayer. January this year, a man called Lou Giglio, a Baptist pastor, was invited to say the prayer at President Obama's second inaugural. And it emerged that 19 or 20 years ago, Giglio had preached a sermon against homosexuality. I don't think he actually said, it's not been a major part of my ministry since. He preached it once, 19 or 20 years ago. It was enough to get him disqualified from saying the prayer at the inaugural, despite all the other good things that he'd done. The culture is changing on this issue at a dramatically fast rate. Why is that? I think it is because the structure of the media is such that the argument hasn't been lost, it's simply been sidelined. My kids have grown up in a world where homosexuality is portrayed as normal. They've grown up in a world of soap operas and sitcoms that have grabbed the popular imagination. They grow up in a world where the television, as I shall talk about a little bit later on, has seized words and completely transformed their meaning. And this poses a huge challenge for the church in terms of how we are to respond to the current context, how we are to make the gospel, if you like, get a hearing for the gospel within this situation. And the final comment I would make on this is, historically it is the case that when huge cultural paradigm shifts take place on matters of great moral importance, it is always cast by the victorious party as a great leap forward in evolution, a great advance, something that means things have dramatically improved. And what that means is that the rhetorical flow of language is pitted precisely against those who hold the traditional former position on things. So, to summarise then, the culture has changed in dramatic ways. I think it is irreversible from a Christian perspective, but it is important for us to know why the culture looks the way it does, what kind of message it's sending, in order to understand how we are to respond. And I want to spend the remainder of this lecture and then the second lecture talking about laying the foundations, if you like, for a Christian response to this. And the first thing I want to say. The first need, I think, is that we need to have a robust theology. We should not take our cues from the world around us. We should, as a church, take our cues from the Word of God. We need a robust theology because then we will understand the task that lies in front of us, and we will have confidence in carrying out that task. And the first element, I think, in having a robust theology is to understand that the struggle in which we are engaged is a supernatural struggle. Think of the book of Job. Job is a fascinating book in many, many ways. Looking, of course, at the mystery of suffering. It also highlights the mystery of God's election, that you have this strange figure, Job. We know very little about him. We know that he wasn't Jewish, and we know that he was a worshipper of God, that he was beloved of God. And those of you who know the story, of course, there is this immense conflict, this figure, Satan, appears before the Lord, and he uses Job as an example of somebody who just worships God for his own benefit. And so the Lord allows Satan to take away all of Job's material comfort, and then when that doesn't crack Job, the Lord allows him to strip him of his health as well. And then you have this amazing series of dialogues between Job and three and then four friends who come to speak to him, to address him in his hour of need. And then right at the end, the Lord himself intervenes. And the intervention of the Lord is mysterious because the last comforter, a young man called Elihu, he's sort of arrogant, but he seems to basically speak the truth. The Lord is sovereign. It's basically Elihu's message. But the Lord comes and speaks after Job. And he does, first of all, he basically puts Job in his place and says, you know, I'm the Lord and, you know, you are as nothing before me. And then, as Job is struck into silence and repentance, the Lord continues and he describes two amazing creatures, the behemoth and the leviathan. And what's interesting, particularly about the language used about the leviathan, is that it is really not language used about a creature at all, or a normal creature, if you like. If you compare the language used about leviathan with the language used elsewhere about Satan himself, I'm persuaded that what the Lord is doing at that point is actually offering Job, he's actually lifting the curtain a bit, and he's allowing Job to see behind the curtain to the great struggle that the reader has known is going on all the time between the Lord and Satan. The message of that, of course, is that this world is a very complicated, bad place. And in large part, that is rooted in the supernatural conflict that goes on behind the scenes. So the first thing, the first element, I think, of a robust theology is to understand that the battle in which the church is engaged is a battle against forces and powers that transcend that of any mere human being. We get hints of this in the New Testament, Luke chapter 5, when the devil comes to tempt Christ in the wilderness. And the devil took him up and showed him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time and said to him, to you I will give all this authority and their glory, for it has been delivered to me, and I give it to whom I will. And Satan, it seems there, is underlining to Christ that he has considerable power at this particular moment in time, that he is the one who calls the shots, in a sense, in the world. So the first thing, the first aspect of a robust theology is to understand that the struggle in which the church is engaged is a supernatural struggle. Second, the second element of a robust theology, and this will become increasingly important, I think, as the years go by, there is such a thing as human nature. There is nothing, I suspect, that human beings naturally dislike more than the fact they have a nature. And nature, of course, is that they are made in the image of God. And that is the one thing that fallen human beings really cannot stand. What is interesting, of course, is that even when we look at the world around us today and there is such plasticity in terms of human nature, where human beings, we're telling ourselves through what we consume, through what we can do that just feels good to us, that there is no such thing as human nature. You can even have a five-year-old claiming to be a transgender person. It is interesting that the language of human rights and morality persists. There is still some acknowledgement deep down inside, much as we hate it, I'm sure, that there is a solidarity, that we are different from other animals. There is something that binds me together with you, that does not bind me together with a piece of rock or a dog or a cat. And, of course, death remains the great leveller. It is interesting for all of the talk of reality as a linguistic construct. Death, perhaps the most real thing of all, is patently not simply a construction of language. Michel Foucault, the great French deconstructionist theorist, died. It was not simply a trick of language. He actually died. Third aspect of a robust theology, human beings know God but suppress the knowledge of him. Romans 1, I think, is very important here. Romans 1 teaches clearly that human beings are designed to worship. They have a knowledge of God, and not only do they have a knowledge of the divine in general, they have a knowledge of the real Creator God. Much as they may flee from that, much as they may dislike that, we need to hold on to that in our evangelistic and our apologetic enterprises. We need to understand that we are not dealing with people who are neutrally disposed towards the truth, nor are we dealing with people who are completely ignorant of the truth. Whatever they may claim, Romans 1 tells us otherwise. We must also understand that the weapons remain the same. However, culture changes around us, the weapons of our warfare remain the same. The power of God is demonstrated in and through the cross. That is applied today through God's word, through the preaching, the declaration of God's word, and it is effective through the prayers of his people. And that, I think, applies both content and form. We need to hold on to that idea. One of the dangers, I think, of looking to the culture around us in order to understand how to make our message powerful in the culture is we can end up aping the methods and the forms of the culture. 1 Corinthians, I think, is very, very important technically from this perspective. Corinth, of course, is an interesting place. It's a port city, but it's also the site of the Isthmian Games in the ancient world. The Isthmian Games the Olympics were an athletic competition, but they also had an event in them, the public speaking, oratory. The great men of Corinth would have been the great orators. We know from ancient texts that orators were highly esteemed in the culture. Not only were they meant to be good speakers, they were also meant to look good as well. We know that they worked out. We know that they had the equivalent of chest waxing in the ancient world. It was actually done with tar. It was extremely painful. And we know about it because we have letters of complaints from people who lived next to the places where the chest waxing went on, complaining about the blood-curdling screams that they would hear all hours of the day. But the point is this, in Corinth, you have a strong rhetorical culture. You have a culture where people have a very, very clear idea of what looks good and compelling when it comes to public speaking. And that, I think, gives us the background to the problems Paul is having. One of the problems that Paul faces, one, they say he's not a great speaker. Well, I suspect that's a relative thing. It's hard to imagine that Paul wasn't something of a compelling speaker. There were riots on occasion when he preached. And secondly, he didn't look good. He was poor and weak of appearance. You can imagine today thinking, well, we're at a church in Corinth. What we need is somebody who looks like the guys out there that everybody respects in order to make the message powerful. And Paul is adamantly against that. Paul says that's the root of the problems at Corinth, of course, is that you have these factions. There's your factions surrounding orators, different fans of different oratorical individuals. So that's taken root in the church. This guy's a better speaker, this guy's better looking. And that's how the church is divided. Paul is very clear, no. The power of the gospel lies in the proclamation of the cross. And the cross, of course, in itself is a repudiation of worldly notions of power and influence. And that is to be reflected in the form of what goes on. So that then would be my fourth point in a robust theology. The weapons remain the same. The cross, God's word, preaching and prayer. Pathetic in some ways as those last three might appear by the cultural standards of the day, it was just the same in Corinth. And that was precisely Paul's prescription there for church growth in Corinth. Next point on robust theology. God's promise to his church. Matthew 16:18. The great temptation in times when the church appears to be being marginalized is not having the same cultural sway that it has had for centuries, is to panic and think that it's going to the dogs. In actual fact, we already know how the story ends. Matthew 16:18 tells us the gates of hell will not prevail. Revelation indicates that everything will come to a happy consummation at the end. We should not have our confidence shaken by the cultural shifts and changes around us. A robust theology is an answer to that. Reflection, particularly upon the Lord's promise to his church. A promise is made to the church, of course, it's not made to any particular individual. Great leaders have come and gone. Some great leaders have fallen terribly. The church remains. And I have to say, when I look at the late Christopher Hitchens, when I look at Richard Dawkins, when I look at Sam Harris, these men are somewhat less daunting to me than Stalin, Mao Zedong, Adolf Hitler, all of whom, as far as I know, are gone, and the church remains. Matthew 16:18. Sometimes the church can be reduced to very small and humble and poor circumstances. This room is relatively full tonight, though the balcony is completely empty. How big is Belfast? How many are we against so many? It doesn't matter. The numbers don't matter. The Lord's promise, rooted in his character, not in the material size of the church, is the thing that is important. So the first need then is to have a robust theology. The second need, and I'm not going to get through all of this, I've been instructed by the ladies doing the tea that I've got to end between 20:15. And I've been around in churches long enough so you don't want to cross the ladies who make the tea. So I will bring it in on time. But the second need, I think, is to understand the church as the primary context for evangelism. And I want to be careful how I parse this. You know, understand the Great Commission. Let me read it to you. Matthew 28:16. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. And when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age." It seems to me that what Jesus is doing there is giving the Great Commission to the church as a whole, not to particular individuals within it. I think often we become very focused on personal evangelism in evangelical circles, and that is a great thing. It is a great thing to be speaking about Jesus to one's non-Christian friends and to be reaching out. But we need to remember that evangelism is the task of the church, not any specific individual. And I think that can be quite liberating because we all have different competencies. And there are some people who are perhaps not entirely competent to give the gospel out in all circumstances to all people who come across their path. Not everybody is competent to be an evangelist. We should all be able to give a reason for the hope that's within us. But we may not be able to answer every question that our non-Christian friends throw at us. I had a small experience of this recently. My oldest son, who's actually just professed faith 2 weeks ago, but about 6 months ago, I became aware something was going on because he was actually starting to question things in the Bible. It's odd to say I was encouraged by that, but if you're a parent, you'll know it's sort of encouraging when suddenly you realize that your kids are actually thinking about what you're telling them and not simply believing it because you're telling them. And these were questions I wasn't competent to answer. Questions on verses and passages in the Old Testament. At Westminster, I'm lucky in that I know people who can answer these questions for me. So I was able to forward his email on and get good answers from colleagues and then send them back to him. I never took credit for them. I always told him which colleague had done it, mainly because if he has a follow-up, then it's better that my colleague deals with them than I deal with them. But it's a great example of how I was not competent to preach the gospel to my kids in that particular context. It raised issues that I simply couldn't deal with. And it was great to be able to turn to somebody else within the church and ask them to deal appropriately and competently with those questions. So I think the first thing we need to think about when we think about evangelism is it's the job of the whole church. Individually, we should not be shouldering the whole responsibility for it ourselves. It means, I think, that churches need to think strategically and ecclesiastically about this. And one of the things that we've implemented at the church where I'm a pastor is that we make a distinction, if you like, between outreach and evangelism. We rent a church building from a group called the Sons of Italy. They're a sort of Catholic drinking club, if you believe. They're very good landlords. In case one of them listens to this on the internet, very, very good landlords. We're very happy with them. The slightly odd thing is that once a year, I was telling David this, they have the right to use the car park on a Sunday morning. So I'm inside preaching, and I can see statues of the Virgin Mary being sort of carried around in the car park outside. But we face a problem as a church, and that is our church looks like an insurance agency. It's just half of a converted building. We can't get permission from the local council to put a big sign outside. The biggest sign outside our building is an insurance agency sign. How do we get ourselves? If we're going to think ecclesiastically about evangelism, how do you do that with a church which doesn't even look like a church? Well, we make a distinction between outreach and evangelism. Outreach is that, we think, which raises the profile of the church in a positive way by doing good works within the community. Not that we consider those good works to be the primary task of the church. Not that we consider those good works to be the gospel. We consider those good works to be that which makes us a positive contributor to the community and makes it plausible for people to come and hear what we have to say on a Sunday or whenever we have an evangelistic meeting. It is striking, I think, in the New Testament how Paul often accents the fact that the church has been prepared for good works. Ephesians 2:10. Those good works are clearly not for justification, but seem to me to be an outward manifestation of God's grace that is to be visible to the world around. So that when people criticize you, everybody will know that it's nonsense because you do these good works. If you look at the book of Titus, he mentions the good works that the church is meant to be doing 5 times. In a pretty small letter, 5 times. Think about the book of Titus. What is the book of Titus? Paul is writing letters from prison, knowing that his own ministry is coming to an end. These are the letters where he's really going to make sure he says everything he wants the church to know about successfully carrying the gospel forward through the next generation. Former sound words, establishment of an eldership and a diaconate, and good works. He emphasizes that the church is to do good works. It's always been interesting to me how even in a secular world in which we live, what is the one Christian group that seems to be welcome everywhere? The Salvation Army. They look ridiculous. They wear these outdated uniforms. They look weird. They look like the kind of people that you'd expect the world to pick on. But they go with impunity into pubs on a Friday night to encourage husbands to go home and be with their wives, and nobody takes them out back and beats them up because they have a plausibility about them, because they do good works. And one of the things I think the church is increasingly going to have to do in a society which is hostile towards it is do these good works of which Paul speaks. If evangelism, if the goal, if you like, of our witnessing is really to get people under the sound of God's word, then we have to make ourselves plausible in the way we can to the wider culture without selling out on things of great importance. I was talking about before the break, I tried to lay out why I thought the church is going to find itself, I suppose if I were to sum it up in a single word, the church is going to find itself increasingly implausible in contemporary culture. I'm not sure that the gospel has ever been naturally believable to people, because of course people don't want to believe the gospel. Dead in trespasses and sins, it is not for us to believe under our own power. But I was trying to argue that there are elements of contemporary culture that make, well, that guarantee increasing hostility and ridicule coming the church's way in the next 10, 15, 20 years, maybe even sooner given the speed of change that I was outlining earlier. And as I said in part one, but I think that the first major part of our response to this has to be a robust theology. We need to understand what the struggle is in which we're engaged, what the weapons, the tools, the instruments by which we can engage in that struggle are. We need to understand the nature of human nature and the nature of fallen human nature. And we need to realize that our success is ultimately rooted in God's promise to his church, not in our visible successes. And then as I came to the second point, I want to argue that evangelism, as part of the Great Commission, is given to the church as a whole. Every individual should be willing to speak about the Lord Jesus Christ to those who ask them for a reason for their confidence and their faith. But we shouldn't get too obsessed with everybody doing everything. That the Great Commission is given to the church. We are a body. There are many parts to that body. Different people have different skills and different strengths. And we should think corporately about how to engage in evangelistic endeavour. And I also drew a distinction between outreach and evangelism. I think evangelism is something that is ultimately done best and most effectively under the preaching of the word, for reasons that I'll come to in a couple of moments. But outreach is going to be increasingly important. And as I said, it is striking to me that in Paul's letter to Titus, he has so much to say about the church doing good works and how that reflects on the church how the outside culture look on that. And of course, what I didn't mention was when Paul lays out qualifications for elders, one of the qualifications that I think is least emphasized when we look to men qualified to hold the office, it should be of good reputation with those outside. That's often not something we think about. I'm on the Candidates and Credentials Committee for the Philadelphia Presbytery of the OPC. And one of the things that is striking to me is how we often don't ask men coming forward for licensure and ordination, you know, what do your neighbours think of you? Well, you have a good reputation with those outside. And Paul is writing, of course, to a culture that is just as hostile as the one that we're entering. So one would expect Paul to be saying things that are extremely relevant in that particular context. And it is striking as if from the emphasis upon good works to the emphasis upon elders who have good reputation with those outside, that Paul is concerned, I think, that the gospel be plausible, or the church be plausible, if you like, in the way that it then has an opportunity to preach the gospel. And that brings me to the question of preaching. If the church is to be the primary context for evangelism, I think there needs to be a restored confidence in what preaching is. We live, another aspect of our culture is that we live in a very technical age. If we have a problem, by and large, we look for techniques to solve it. You see this in the downplaying of character in a lot of roles, politics and places like that. Character plays less and less role, it seems to me, as the years go by, and there's more emphasis upon does the person have the skill set, the techniques, the ability to do the job. If we think of preaching in terms of technique, then we should really abandon it for something else. Already outlined in the first half of the lecture how the culture has really won the war against Christianity, not so much by answering the arguments as it has by bypassing them altogether and communicating more effectively. Communicating through commercials, advertisements, communicating through soap operas, communicating through situation comedies, communicating through visual news programs. All of these things create images. They predispose us, I think, to thinking not so much in terms of truth or falsity, but good or bad, tasteful or distasteful. If preaching is just technique, then we need to abandon it, because there are better ways of communicating, better techniques for communication. But I think preaching remains important because it is not simply technique. Preaching has a confrontational and theological power rooted in what it is. Preaching, I think, from a Protestant perspective, is the mediation of the presence of God. It's very significant that... Is there a table? There isn't a table down there, but I'm assuming, David, when you have communion, the table is down at the front. The architecture of this church is very, very significant. The pulpit stands above the table if you go into a Catholic church or a Catholic cathedral, and the architect knows his theology. Then as soon as you walk through the door, your eyes will be drawn to the far end of the cathedral or the church where the altar is, because that's where the most important thing takes place. In medieval Catholicism, the Mass is the moment when Christ is present with the people. Thomas Aquinas talks about it as being the most important of the seven sacraments, because the other sacraments point to Christ. The Mass brings Christ. Architecture reflects that. It is a self-conscious move by the Reformation to raise the pulpit, to place it center, and to place it above the table. Not because the 16th century is an oral culture, and that's the best way to communicate to people. Middle Ages was an oral culture. It's making a theological point that the Word of God is the way in which, if you like, God is made savingly, powerfully present to his people. I think it has a good biblical precedent. If you look at the Old Testament, one of the most fundamental aspects of God's identity is that he's a God who speaks. In creation, there was nothing but God. God speaks, there is something. If you look at his address to Adam and Eve, Adam is allowed to name all the creatures, but God names Adam. There's something powerful in God's naming of Adam. God enters into covenant with Abraham. God enters into covenant with the children of Israel at Sinai. And in all of these things, words are powerful and important. God is a speaking God. And then when we come to the prophets, of course, the prophets are those who make God present through their speaking. One of my favorite stories in the Old Testament is the story of the Shunammite. You know the tale, this lady, she couldn't have children, but she's a rather delightful lady, very wealthy. She builds, I suppose, what we would now call a sort of granny annex or a little flat on top of her house, so that whenever Elisha passes through town, he has somewhere to stay. She's a very godly lady, and she's looking out for the man of God. And as a result of this, the man of God says to her, "What can we do for you?" And she says, "There's nothing you can do for me. I live among my people. I've got everything I need." But the servant points out that this lady doesn't have children, which was presumably an emotional drain to her and a source, of course, in the ancient world of considerable social shame. But so selfless was she, didn't bring this to his attention. Well, the man of God says that she's going to have a child, and she does, and the child grows up, and who knows how old he is. He's old enough to be out with his father in the fields, but young enough to sit on his parents' lap. Child has some kind of stroke or aneurysm or something one day and drops down dead. And the woman runs to the prophet, and you know the story. She finds the prophet, she throws herself at the prophet's feet, says to him, "I didn't ask for a child, you gave me a child, now the child's been taken away." And what does the prophet do? He hands his staff to his servant and he says, "Run as fast as you can. Don't greet anybody on the road. Run as fast as you can and lay your staff on the boy." And the servant heads off, but the woman won't leave. The woman stays clutching the prophet and demanding that he come. Why is that? Because he's the one who brings the word of God to Israel at that point. He's the one through whom God is savingly present, if you like. She doesn't want the monkey. She wants the organ grinder to come. God's speech is a mode of his presence. We see this, of course, in the book of Amos, when Amos describes his various famines, and finally he comes to the last and most terrible famine of all. What is the last and most terrible famine of all? It's a famine of the Word of God. Why is that the most terrible famine of all? Because that speaks of the absence of God from his people. Yes, God is present everywhere in a sort of bare metaphysical sense. But he's not covenantally, savingly present with his people when he doesn't speak to them. So God's word is a powerful means of his presence. And that, I think, is something we need to grasp again today. We cannot argue people into the kingdom of God. You can come up with the best arguments you can think of, and they will not persuade people to come in. A good example of this, I think, comes from the 17th century philosopher Blaise Pascal. Some of you will know Blaise Pascal lays out what he calls a wager. I think the wager is generally misinterpreted by people. The idea is, if God exists and you don't believe in him, the consequences are catastrophic. If God doesn't exist and you do believe in him, well, you've really lost nothing. And so the idea is you should play, as they say in rugby, play the percentage game and believe in God. That, I think, is a misreading of what Pascal is saying. If Pascal's saying that, then he's contradicting pretty much everything he writes about Christianity elsewhere. And he's clearly contradicting the Apostle Paul, who says, you know, if in this life only we have hope, we're of all people most to be pitied. I think what Pascal is saying is this. You spend your whole life as a percentage game. You'll leave here tonight and you'll cross the road at the point when you think you have most chance of surviving. You know, if I walk out of here tonight and I see you running in front of an oncoming bus, I'm going to assume you're either trying to kill yourself or you're mad. You're not going to do that. You're going to wait till the bus has passed and you think you've got a good chance of survival, then you'll cross the road. What Pascal, I think, is doing in his wager is this. He's saying that even though you live your whole life as a percentage game, you make an exception in this one area. Even though you know the odds are such, of gain and loss are such, that it makes no sense not to believe in God, still you won't believe in him. What Pascal is actually doing is exposing the moral foundations of unbelief. That not believing in God is not ultimately an intellectual decision based on analysis. It is a moral decision based on a refusal. We cannot argue people into the kingdom, and that is why I think preaching retains its importance. Preaching is the means by which God confronts people with his presence and his claims upon them. And we need to have a good theology of preaching in order to have confidence in our outreach and evangelism. So all of this is to say that the culture and self-understanding of the church is important. We need a solid theology of what we're doing when we gather together for worship. A solid understanding that preaching's power ultimately lies in the cross and in God's presence, not in the rhetorical tricks and the power of our logic. And we also need to understand that we have to have a church culture that makes our claims plausible. Again, to return to Paul's pastoral letters, it's very striking, isn't it, that he has that section on women's attire in 1 Timothy, preached through 1 Timothy a couple of years ago. It's tough to preach on that passage when you look out and you see the very nice ladies in the congregation wearing pearl earrings. And you think, oh dear, how am I going to apply this and, you know, get out the door and survive? I made a critical comment to that Downton Abbey once, and I only just got out with my skin at the end of the day as the sisterhood gathered en masse at the exit. Paul isn't getting, I don't think, at pearl earrings in that letter. What he's describing there is the attire that in that culture was the convention for powerful, sexually promiscuous women. What Paul is saying in that letter is when people come into the church, then what they're hearing from the pulpit should coordinate with what they're seeing in people's lives. And I think that has broader application than just the way we dress, to the way we treat outsiders, to the good works we do. I think given the nature of the secular culture in which we are in, we need to make sure that the cultures of our individual congregations make it plausible for people to listen to what we have to say. Some of you I know have read the book by Rosaria Butterfield, who's an RPCNA pastor's wife now. She was a professor of queer theory at, Syracuse University, which is a very impressive university in the United States. She was an active lesbian, and she was going to give a lecture. And she had a lot of hate mail from Christians, except for one letter, which was this nice letter from an RPCNA pastor inviting her to join him and his wife for dinner, talk about these things. And it was the beginning of an unlikely friendship that culminated in the conversion of this lady. Not only did she cease to be a lesbian professor at Syracuse and effectively threw her whole career into the rubbish bin, she became an exclusive psalmist RP as well, which is about as, if there was a sharper change than 180 degrees, one would want to use it at this point. But there isn't. It's a remarkable story. But what's striking about her story is that it was the attitude of the minister that made the gospel, listening to the gospel, shall I say, plausible to her. Because she could see that what he said and the way he treated other people matched up. That wasn't the reason why she believed in the end, but it was the reason why she sat and listened to what he had to say. So, church culture, friendliness, openness to strangers and visitors, combined with a seriousness of purpose, very important. Third major need, a thorough understanding of the Bible. We need to know the story of the Bible as a whole in order to give meaning to the parts. I think this is very important. It's particularly important for preachers, Sunday school teachers and elders to consciously work at cultivating a knowledge of the whole Bible in congregations. Elders need to be conscientious in cultivating well-rounded faith in individual congregants. We'll talk a little bit about this later on, but I think it's where creeds and confessions can be so valuable. One reason for this is, I think, the way that words have been hijacked by the wider culture and have had their meaning fundamentally changed. It's one reason, I think, why Christians are losing the culture war, because the language has been hijacked and disemboweled of its traditional meaning. Think, for example, of the word love. It's very striking, if you ask a typical person, what does love mean? If you look at the television and ask what images of love are projected, by and large, I think, love can be reduced to sexual attraction, emotional connection, not getting in somebody else's way as they seek to fulfill themselves. These are now the definitions of love that are operative in our culture. And I wonder how many Christians, if asked, well, by a non-Christian, define love from a Christian perspective for me. What does God's love look like? Would be able to give a convincing answer based on the Bible as to what it looks like. I was struck the other week. I'm preaching through Malachi in the mornings. And Malachi, it's the last book of the Old Testament. It's very short. And it's a series of six disputations between God and his people, where God makes a claim, the people question, how can this be so? And then God buries them with his answer. And the first claim God makes is, I love my people. And the people say, how have you loved us? And what God does not say is, well, when I think of you, I get like a warm, sentimental feeling. I look at my people and I think, that's my people. Makes me feel all kind of warm and cozy inside. That's not God's response at all. Nor is his response to say, well, I allow my people to fulfill themselves. I get out of their way and I'm just there to help them fulfill themselves and fulfill their potential and be exactly who they want to be. What the Lord says is, I crushed your enemies. I wiped Edom off the face of the map, and if Edom ever comes back, I'll wipe him off the face of the map again. Very interesting definition of love. If you don't know your Bible, you'd never get that from the wider culture. Love means defending somebody from their enemies. It makes me wonder, what does somebody mean when they say, I don't love my wife anymore? If you think of love in those terms, it's a meaningless statement, really. Love is not a sentiment. Love is an imperative command. You say, I don't love my wife anymore. I'm not going to defend my wife from her enemies anymore. That's what you're saying. Knowing the Bible is extremely important because we have to understand the fundamental differences between the way we use words and the way culture uses words. Think about marriage. How do we respond to current debates about marriage? Maybe this is going to sound a little bit sharp, but I'm not convinced that the permission of homosexual marriage redefines marriage. That's the language that's often used, isn't it? They're trying to redefine marriage. I actually think marriage was redefined when we allowed no-fault divorces. That's what redefined marriage. Everything else is just a sort of unraveling of that at this point. Because no-fault divorces really turn marriage into nothing more than an emotional or sexual attraction. Once you've disemboweled marriage of the meaning of two people where the one will protect the other and be fully committed and united to the other in that kind of bond, everything else we see is a logical unraveling. And it strikes me how hard it is now for Christians to argue against gay marriage because we kind of conceded the meaning of love a while back to love being just emotional sexual attraction. Well, if that's all love is, then marriage is something very different from the way the Bible describes it. We've already, if you like, opened the gate and the horse has well and truly bolted. I was struck recently reading Ross Douthat's book. It probably doesn't work so well over here. It's a book called Bad Religion, looking at how religion went wrong in the United States. And he says this. He's talking about how the language has been seized by a wider culture and completely inverted in meaning. He said, pride has become self-esteem. Vanity has become self-improvement. Adultery becomes following your heart. Greed and gluttony become living the American dream. Isn't that true? How do we combat that? We have to have a firm understanding that there is no common ground, if you like, between the way the world uses language and the way we do. It's not just a question of giving a reason for the hope that's within us. We've got to define hope. There's no common agreement even on what hope would mean at this point. And yet I think there is, if you'll pardon the slight pun here, there is hope. I think we think about the richness of biblical narratives. There are points of contact that allow us to speak to people today with power. I'm not a biblical scholar at all. I teach history. History was my major focus. It was ancient history as an undergraduate, then Reformation history as a postgrad. One of my favorite characters is Martin Luther. And I've always been fascinated as to how Luther became the popular figure he did. 95 Theses is very famous, of course, but if you ever try to read the 95 Theses, utterly tedious. You need to have a reasonable understanding of late medieval theology to understand the 95 Theses. It's not a cool document at all. It's very, very tedious. It's a great mystery to me as to why it becomes such a popular tract when 90% of the people reading it wouldn't really have understood what he was trying to say. But Luther had a genius for taking hold of the language that people used and subverting it with biblical intent. And I think we need to think about that today. And the great example for me is in 1520. Just give a little bit of background on the Reformation. If you were, let's say you were a peasant radical in the early part of the 16th century, and you and I had been sitting in a tavern one evening, and I'd said to you, "What do you want from life?" You'd have said to me, "I want justice. That's what I want. I want justice." By the time we get to 1520, we know that the language of peasant radicalism has changed. If we'd been sitting in that same tavern, I'd say, "You know, 20 years ago, we had a conversation, and you say, do you still want justice?" You'd have said, "No, I want freedom." 1520, Martin Luther writes one of his most important works, The Freedom of the Christian Man. It's an amazing piece of work, and it was misunderstood by some, but essentially what Luther does is he takes the language of freedom, and he totally subverts it. He says, Christians are free. And then he goes on to talk about freedom in terms of freedom from the curse of the law. Freedom from the need to do deeds of righteousness to get right with God, because you're right already and you're therefore free to work for other people. But what Luther did was he grabbed hold of language that the world, the culture around, understood and filled it with biblical content. Freedom might be, it certainly works in some contexts. I know in the African-American context in the United States, if you're a Presbyterian pastor trying to plant a church in an African-American area and don't have the word liberation in the title of your church, it's not going to work. The language of freedom of liberation resonates strongly with that community. One of the problems we face today is, people don't understand sin anymore. But then think about the biblical narrative and how sin can sometimes be presented. Mark chapter 5, I think, is a very useful text to reflect on. Mark chapter 5 falls into two halves. They're actually intimately connected. In the first half, you have the demoniac of the Gerasenes, this pathetic character he's occupied by so many demons that when Christ asks what the name is, he says, "I'm Legion." Think about what Legion, how that would have resonated with an occupied Palestine at that time. The Legion, that was the armies of occupation of Rome. This man is an occupied country in himself by demonic powers. He lives among the tombs. No man can bind him because they put chains around him and he snaps them off. And yet the Lord Jesus comes, speaks a word, drives out the demons, and leaves the man clean and in his own mind. And then in the second half of the chapter, we have this incident. The synagogue ruler comes to Christ. His child is dying, and he wants Jesus to come and speak to his 12-year-old daughter who's dying. And Jesus goes to move on his way, and as he's moving on his way, of course, the crowd are pushing around him. There's a woman who's had a flow of blood for 12 years, as it happens, same as the child's age, reaches out, touches him, and the blood flow stops. And Jesus goes on and he raises, the girl has died because of the delay to deal with the woman, and Jesus raises the little girl from the dead. The 12 years is an interesting detail, isn't it? Why does Mark tell us that the girl was 12 years old? I think he's reminding us that as you get old, 12 years seems like a drop in the ocean. When you're suffering, it seems like a long time. And this girl, this woman with the flow of blood, she'd suffered for 12 long years. She'd have counted every second of those years. What is it that binds the two halves of that chapter together? Dirt. Dirt. Dirtiness. The Old Testament is very clear that when a woman has her monthly flow of blood, she is unclean. And anything she touches is unclean. The demoniac, demons are filthy, and he lives among the tombs. Anybody who touches anything that's touched a dead body is unclean. The little girl is the most unclean of all. She's died. And in each case, Christ touches them. And we're told very clearly in the Old Testament that what's meant to happen at that point is that Christ becomes dirty. In actual fact, in each case, the demoniac, the woman with the flow of blood, the little girl is made clean. That's a great evangelistic passage for the world in which we live. People say they don't understand sin anymore. But listen to the language that's used on television. The language of dirt still resonates. Somebody tells you, it was a dirty deal. I was a dirty politician. That's a dirty book or a dirty film. Even the world in which we live understands and uses that language. That's language of transgression. It's language of transgression. A careful reflection upon Scripture, I think, really allows us to find points of contact with the culture that we may not think are there. The language has changed. Some of the content has changed. But people still have a concept of sin. Romans 1. People still have a concept of sin. They may not call it that anymore. They might gloss it in many ways. Remember that passage in, I think it was in the Aeneid, when Queen Dido sleeps with Aeneas, and the poet says, she calls it marriage. By this name she hides her guilt. It's a great Romans 1 passage, isn't it? People still resonate with the language of dirt. A thorough understanding of the Bible and a constructive reflection on the Bible relative to what is around us, I think, offers us some hope at this point of still being able to communicate gospel truths into a hostile culture. More briefly, just a few more brief points. Fourth need, I think there's a need for confessions. Confessions, I think, fulfill two functions. And I'm thinking here about the confession that a church has. Its doctrinal standard, if you like. If you're a Presbyterian, it's the Westminster Confession. If you're a Baptist, it might be the London Confession. Or if you're Independent, your church may have its own confession. Very important for two reasons. One, I think they're important for transparency. Again, it goes back to that plausibility thing. An upfront public confession limits the power of the church and the eldership and sends a signal to people that you're not a cult. I think confessions will become more important from that perspective as the years go by. And secondly, I think confessions, particularly elaborate confessions, provide a certain comprehensiveness of thinking that is important for Christians who want to witness coherently to the world around. When somebody becomes a Christian, there is a need for a comprehensive change, ultimately, in the way they think. Rosaria Butterfield's book is a great example of that. She goes from lesbian queer theory professor to an RPCNA pastor's wife. Confessions set the bar for the comprehensiveness of what we expect from our people. And we need to be producing comprehensive converts if they're to be able to give a reason for the hope that's within them. Fifth, and this sort of arises out of the others I get, do not be intimidated. A lot of the power of contemporary atheism comes from its harnessing of the power of the media. That does not necessarily mean it has true spiritual power at all. As I said earlier on, many of these characters compare rather unfavorably to the great hostile atheists of the past. You know, I'd rather be dealing ultimately with Richard Dawkins than with Joseph Stalin. Don't be intimidated. I think another thing that one to do is one must realize or take advantage of the material that is being produced that debunks much of the atheist mythology that surrounds the church. A particularly good book that I'd recommend, or two books I'd recommend to you. One is entitled Atheist Delusions by the philosopher and historian David Bentley Hart. It's a scholarly work. David Bentley Hart teaches at the University of Virginia. He's not some crank out there with his own printing press, just producing his own books. This is a scholarly book. It's entitled Atheist Delusions. And what Bentley Hart does is he looks at the historical claims made by the great atheists of our day and completely debunks them. You know, he's not debunking Dan Brown. Any five-year-old on Wikipedia can debunk Dan Brown. David Bentley Hart really looks at historiography underlying some of the very confident claims about church history made by the likes of Christopher Hitchens and company, who write very eloquently and passionately. And I think in David Bentley Hart have met their match. I think, David, you'd agree with me. He's an extremely amusing writer. I'm one of those people, I'd probably never want to review one of his books, because if you did it badly, he would bury you somewhere, I'm sure. I would also want to recommend Mike Kruger and Andreas Kirstenberger's book, The Heresy of Orthodoxy, which is a treatment of the New Testament canon. Some of you will know that some of the biggest assaults on the Christian faith are coming from those who have discovered new gospels or asking why certain gospels that appeared in the first 5 centuries were never included in the Christian canon. It can look very intimidating. Kirstenberger and Kruger, I think, do an excellent job in debunking that. Do not allow polite atheism to avoid the hard questions. There are very few atheists I've come across who are willing to actually push their position to its logical conclusion. Nietzsche, 19th century German philosopher, is often thought of as an anti-Christian thinker. And certainly he was. Much of his polemic was targeted against the church. But he was also an anti-polite atheist thinker as well. I'll read you a section from his book, The Gay Science, here. Scene is this. There is a town centre, and in the town there are a whole bunch of polite, gentlemanly atheists wandering around, going about their civilised daily business. And suddenly a madman appears in their midst to announce the death of God and to demand that they take this death of God, the God whom they have killed, he says, that they take it seriously. Have you not heard, Nietzsche says, of that madman who lit a lantern in the bright morning hours, ran to the marketplace and cried incessantly, "I seek God, I seek God." As many of those who did not believe in God were standing around just then, these are polite atheists, he provoked much laughter. "Has he got lost?" asked one. "Did he lose his way like a child?" asked another. "Is he hiding? Is he afraid of us? Has he gone on a voyage? Has he emigrated?" Thus they yelled and laughed. The madman jumped into their midst and pierced them with his eyes. "Where is God?" he cried. "I will tell you. We have killed him, you and I. All of us are his murderers. But how do we do this? How could we drink up the sea? Who gave us the sponge to wipe away the entire horizon? What were we doing when we unchained this earth from its sun? Whither is it moving now? Whither are we moving? Away from all suns? Are we not plunging continually? Backward, sideward, forward, in all directions? Is there still any up or down? Are we not straying as through an infinite nothing? Do we not feel the breath of empty space? Has it not become colder? Is not night continually closing in on us? Do we not need to light lanterns in the morning? Do we hear nothing as yet of the noise of the grave diggers who are burying God?" The madman sees that the death of God renders everything meaningless and turns the universe into a battle of the most powerful. Again, very interesting, in a debate before Christmas, there was a person representing, I was asked if I would represent St. Augustine, the rules of debate where you have to stick within the parameters of the thought of the person you're representing. And this church had got me to come in and represent St. Augustine. And they got the chairman of the local Bertrand Russell Society to come in and represent Bertrand Russell. And we scored a few good points off each other, but at the end of the evening, I read that passage to him and said, "You're opposed to nuclear weapons. You're outraged at the fact that nuclear weapons can wreak such destruction on the created world. On what basis are you outraged? If everything is meaningless, if there is no God, why are you outraged? Have the courage of your convictions to see everything as meaningless as it was." And he couldn't do it. And then there was another interesting moment where we were asked, what was the thing that you would criticize in your thinker? What was the one place where you would want to distance yourself from your thinker? And of course, Bertrand Russell lived a very promiscuous life. And it was interesting to me that when the chairman of the debate turned to the Bertrand Russell man, his wife and daughter in the audience, and he immediately said, "Oh, I'd have to disagree with him on marriage. You have to be faithful to your wife." I thought, isn't that interesting? His wife's in the audience. He can't get away at this point with saying anything but that. For all of his The world is just a collection of random atoms. Make the most of it. He has a moral sense. Romans 1. He couldn't suppress the truth in all circumstances. So a final point then. Do not be intimidated by the swagger of contemporary atheism. Paul faced a much more brutal challenge in the ancient world, a culture that was much more hostile. He had fewer people and fewer financial resources at his disposal. Yet he turned the world upside down. Isn't it fascinating that he writes to the church in Corinth that was probably a church of about 60 or 70 people, according to the commentaries I've looked at. A church of 60 or 70 people, torn apart by factionalism and by sexual immorality. And he calls it the body of Christ and the temple of the Holy Spirit. And if you know your Bible, you know by calling the church the temple, he's saying to that bunch of sleazy, divided people in Corinth, you are the meaning of history. So if I could sum up this evening then, the culture will be increasingly hostile to us. We should accept that. Our response to that is, first of all, not to take our cue from the culture and to panic. Our response to that should, first of all, be learn our own theology well. Draw confidence from our theology. Secondly, have a renewed understanding of the importance of the church, that no Christian is in this alone. Evangelism is the task of the church as a whole. We need to work as a team. The church is the recipient of God's promise in a way that no individual is. Thirdly, we need to have a thorough understanding of the Bible. We need to know it from beginning to end. It's not just words like God that the world out there no longer understands. It's words like love and hope as well. Marriage, all of these words have lost their meaning. And they gain their meaning for us only by knowing the Bible from cover to cover and understanding the story of God's redemption. Fourthly, we need confessions. Confessions, I think, are part of our good testimony to those outside, but they also lay out a comprehensive picture of what doctrinal Christian discipling should look like. And then fifth, we should not be intimidated. Just because the media plays one story does not mean it's the truth. We're saying to students, just because you lose an argument doesn't mean that you weren't on the right side. I could debate, I'm guessing, almost any student at Westminster Seminary on 17th century Puritan theology and win, even if I was wrong, because I could just outflank them in the end, every step of the way. It doesn't mean you're wrong because the odds look so great. Spend your time reading good books that address the issues in profound ways. Life is surely too short to read the second or third best book on any subject. And then do not allow polite atheism to get away with being polite. When you talk to non-Christian friends, push them hard on where their assumptions should actually take them.